So this is one way of putting it, the Hamilton principle. Government should be involved in banking. And that is to contrast with this. Oh. And for the sake of being sentimental, let's play the tape, Aaron.
No one 12 months ago was talking about a global financial crisis. Now everybody is talking about a global financial crisis.
How do you cover an economic crisis as deep and confusing as... Nobody seems to know what's going on in the world. Nobody seems to know. Nobody has a crystal ball.
And if there have been any lessons learned, Mr. Speaker, over the last 30 years in Australia, it is the government should not be involved in banking.
So that is our Homeowners and Bank Protection Bill, the only solution video. And that was Joe Hockey in early 2009. That was his takeaway from the global financial crisis. What it taught us, that government should not be involved in banking. So let's contradict him. But first, before we do, let's see what time of day it is, because we are roaring into another global financial crisis. Now, we've been saying that for a while. This is what news.com.au said last week. If we go through those clips, next one, please. All right, what News did, this is a slight preview if you have, for the next CEC report. Craig and I covered this on Friday. News had seven signs of economic Armageddon. And what was totally striking about the seven signs is they are all things that the CEC has been jumping up and down about for a long, long time. And so we'll just go through, they included some graphs in their article. By the way, this is their report of an analysis by a government economic advisor named John Adams, who formerly worked for Arthur Sinodinos. So this is not a nobody, this is not an external crank, this is not one of those zero hedge outside the system commentators. This is Arthur Sinodinos' former advisor, right? That same Arthur Sinodinos, and I suspect he doesn't know anything about what's happening in the global financial system too. So this is these type of graphs speak for themselves. Look at Australia's record household debt, and it's not just record for us. It's the highest, or one of the very highest in the world. Next slide. Net foreign debt as a percent of GDP is now over $1 trillion, and that's net, which means the gross is over $2 trillion. And what that means is that it's good that it starts here, because this is when the tariff cuts happened and all these cheap imports that flooded Australia, we haven't been able to pay for. That's what our net foreign debt means, right? So it's been great and everyone will tell you how great trade is, but we haven't been able to pay for it. We have capitalized on our first world status and our rich minerals to have a good credit line, right? And external creditors are willing to lend us money. That's what's paying for it. We aren't paying for it ourselves. Next one. This was in there because when interest rates are this low, where can they go? And if you look, negative. This is what happened. This is what they were able to do to respond to the global financial crisis. What can they do now? That's what it took then. What will it take now? Right? They've lost that option for dealing with it, and it wouldn't have been able to deal with it anyway. Next one. This is, I had to confess, is an aspect of this picture that I hadn't quite thought of, as an angle I hadn't looked at. We've been yelling about the property bubble. What this graph shows is just how much credit has gone into the property bubble as a percent of GDP. And looking around the audience here now, I would wager a bunch of you were homeowners in 1991, right? When, yes, interest rates were high, but house prices were much, much smaller and it was easier to get a house in Australia, right? Look at, back then, only 20%, like the total credit in the housing market was the equivalent of 20% of a much, much lower GDP. Now it's 90% of a much, much higher GDP. This is bonkers, right? That's the bubble. That's not, that, that's There's no supply and demand here in this housing bubble. That's the bubble. Banks have been allowed to plough money into it. Where are we? Okay, so these are predicates for Australia. And then the article went on, they didn't provide graphs for this, but the article went on to talk about the global situation, including the global derivatives crisis. And for a news.com.au, the most mainstream of all mainstream tabloid publications in Australia, to devote space to the serious issue of derivatives and the international crisis and how that's a threat to us was quite stunning. So that's some Australian predicates. Let's look at Europe. Here you have... This is the current situation in the UK. I'm not going to try and explain this graph. The only thing to explain is this bit. Those mean that these banks have failed Bank of England stress tests, right? And the stress tests were framed on similar circumstances to 2008. Now, there's an epistemological flaw there. Because what they're saying is, oh, if we go through something similar, how will our banks fare? Well, they failed if it's something similar. But it's never something similar, right? If banks knew what was going to crash them next, they wouldn't be doing it. You can't actually stress test the future. That's why you need something like Glass-Steagall. Just put all the threats aside. So that's the state in London. This bank here, RBS, which failed the worst, that's a British government-owned bank. Oops. 8 years after the crash and the British government had to nationalise it, it's still in a basket case of a bank, yes. Right? Next one. And now we're getting into the real territory, right? So this is Deutsche Bank's derivatives compared not just to Germany's GDP, but to Europe's GDP as a whole. And of course, that is the black hole in the middle of the European financial system. And you've all seen the spiderweb graphic with Deutsche Bank, right? I haven't put it here, through that is connected to the whole world. But as if you saw the Daisuke Kotagawa's interview with Michael Billington of EIR back in October, he made the point, Deutsche Bank is not a German bank. It is a British bank. And look at this, say, there's its derivatives, but then look at this picture. Euro-denominated derivatives are all traded in London. Right? That's the real black hole of the European banking system. It actually isn't Deutsche Bank. It's the City of London, as it always has been anyway. Then you had this analysis come out the other day. This is quite interesting. This gentleman, Bruce Wilds, has done his own independent investigation of derivatives because there's official reporting of derivatives, but the biggest problem, and as bad as that official reporting is, like the Bank for International Settlements has, you know, derivatives statistics for all the banks in the world and for all the countries in the world, that puts it at about $500 trillion. And as bad as that picture is, everybody has known for a long time that the real picture is much worse. And I'll give you an example. We had a young guy visit us around the time of the crash, Bryce. Yeah. What's his last? I forget his last name. We interviewed him. Anyway, this young fella had backpacked around Europe after doing uni, and he got a job in London just before the crash, working in the back room of the big banks like JP Morgan. And his job was to write up the derivatives contracts when the salesman made the sales. So you have derivatives salesmen in the front room making the derivatives sales, and they'd rush into the back room, throw in the paperwork, and write this up. And so he had to beaver away all day writing up these things. He could never track down those salesmen to get them to sign the damn contract, right? So when the crash happened, like with Lehman Brothers, this was acknowledged, there was piles of paper in Lehman Brothers offices, and that's just one bank, all the banks were the same, of unsigned, uncompleted contracts that had started working, but no one was having any ownership of these things, right? And these would not be counted in the official statistics. And this was the insanity of the global financial system. So we're already talking about official figures are in the hundreds of trillions. This gentleman, Bruce Wilds, quoted an English mathematician who made it his business to try and figure out what might the real picture be, and he came to the same figure that EIR has used for a long time, which is he suggested around $1,200 trillion, right? 1.2 quadrillion. Now, that's also important because it contradicts the claim that since the last crash, derivatives have cooled off, and it means they actually haven't. And then of course, I don't have a graph for it, but you then go to the United States, which has a $2 trillion exposure to that European situation, and on top of that, the four American banks, just four, account for $220 trillion of the $1,200 trillion derivatives pile. Just four American banks account for that much of it, right? So the whole world is faced with this very severe threat. So, question for you. What do we do about it? Give me a formula. Glass-Steagall. Anything else? National banking. Anything else? Yay! All right, who agrees with this? Who agrees with this solution? Okay. That's unnecessarily vindictive. You could make an argument that if we actually implemented everything else, they would be so emotionally traumatized by that, they wouldn't need jail, right? We could let them have jobs as butlers for people who used to be poor, something like that. Okay. Now we're going to change this a little bit, though, because I don't want to make this a class about banking and these issues. I'm assuming you know what they are. What I want to discuss, because this is an activist workshop, is how we convey these ideas, right? Because you heard Stu Rosenblatt yesterday, and Stu is the guy that we should all be inspired by. He spends all his money, all his time on Capitol Hill, driving around the country, going to state legislators, but on Capitol Hill, pressing the case for Glass-Steagall non-stop, incessantly, him and Angela. And they're so effective at it that JP Morgan spend hundreds of millions of dollars on a team of lobbyists whose real job is to combat Stu Rosenblatt. That's the real issue. There's a JP Morgan. This was shown up about 3 years ago when there was a state legislators convention, and Stu had done all this preparatory work, and there was all these state legislators turning up to talk about Glass-Steagall and have a motion passed on Glass-Steagall like we were going to have at the councillors convention in Sydney a couple of years ago. And JP Morgan sent a team down there, and they were having fights in the corridors with our people, right? Because that's what it was. And here's the richest, most powerful bank in the world versus an organisation that's got no money, no resources, just ideas and truth, and that was the fight. It's called asymmetric warfare, right? So that guy there, who's in the heat of battle every day, he told you what to do. Now, what did you, any takeaways from what he said?
Goo goo, gaga. Ah!
Okay, so I don't like using the term keep it simple, stupid, but he had another way of putting it, which is, talk to them like they're a second grader, right? And so I prefer the term uncomplicated. Don't make it simple, just don't complicate it. There's no need to complicate it. And we're going to talk about national banking and stuff like that, but I don't want to get into the nitty-gritties. I don't want to talk about fractional reserve banking and all those types of things, right? Tier 1 equity and tier 2 equity and all that contingent convertible capital. We're not going to discuss that. If you want to know it, fine. There's a million things you can read and you can study it, and that's great. But it's going to be zero help when you're trying to explain something in a few seconds to people. So what we're going to do is focus on what's real and what's not real. And if you can convey what's real and what's not real, we're going to win this fight. Okay, so first of all, here's my little bit of entertainment. Yep. The day $100 came to town. So let's read this story. It's a slow day in Baralaba. or Baraba, or Baraba, whatever you call it. Or what other little towns are there? Hobart. The sun is hot, the streets are deserted, times are tough, everybody's in debt, everybody lives on credit. Sound familiar? On this particular day, a rich tourist from back west is driving through town. He stops at the motel and lays a $100 bill on the desk, saying he wants to inspect the room upstairs in order to pick one to spend the night. As soon as the man walks upstairs, the owner grabs the bill and runs next door to pay his debt to the butcher. The butcher takes $100 and runs down the street to retire his debt to the pig farmer. The pig farmer takes $100 and heads off to pay his bill at the feed store. The guy at the feed store at the farmer's co-op takes $100 and runs to pay his debt to the local prostitute, who has also been facing hard times and has had to offer her services on credit. She, in a flash, rushes to the motel and pays off her room bill with the motel owner. The motel proprietor now places $100 back on the counter so the rich traveller will not suspect anything. At that moment, he comes downstairs, picks up the money and leaves, states the rooms are not satisfactory, pockets the money and leaves. Now this, some of you might have seen this before. This circulated at the time of the global financial crisis. This went all around the internet, right? As to epitomise what's wrong with the financial system. So I got a question, what is wrong with it? There's a voice at the back says no wealth creation. Costa?
Can we have that in a pamphlet?
Well, wait till we finish the discussion. You may change your mind.
Is that 10-cent Ponzi scheme? Anyone else?
I would suggest that it says that money is lost. There's no value, but it is a voucher for the means of goods and services, because the girls are so.
Give the man a round of applause. This is the guy who recruited me. There's nothing wrong with this story. This is how the economy works.
Can I add one thing, Robbie, that's missing out on the whole thing? Evaluating the products.
Oh, GST, mate.
Well, physical profit in the system. It's not existing. It's just all consumers.
No, first of all, though, I want to point out. No, okay. Where is the value in the story? It's the money. Is the money the value?
No.
All the value has been exchanged.
Yeah. The wealth creation, if that $100 created all that
did. No. The wealth was already created. It was the credit had facilitated the exchange of real things in the economy. And all the money did was come along and, after the fact, be the medium of exchange to retire the debts. Right?
Yep.
This is what happened. The reason people got fooled by this is because their initial thinking is the money is the value. Right? One note passes through town and goes out, what's happened? Right? And they thought, this is what's wrong with the system. No, it's not what's wrong with the system. What's wrong with the system, I'm going to give you some examples of in a little bit. But that is something, a little trick there, my little time bomb for you all, that when you see the world, and when you see the world economy, learn to look for what's real so you can point out to other people what is real and what is not, right? Because that's a great story. Credit kept that economy going. And we'll finalise that later. Okay. So let's be clear. Let's do a bit of thinking, put our thinking caps on. Let's be clear, what is the real economy? So I've got a question for you. What do you people have in common in terms of your needs with everybody, every human being who has ever lived, and every human being who ever will live, and all human beings in the world today? What needs do you share in common?
Food, electricity, sanitation,
oxygen,
warmth at night.
Food,
pyramid of wine.
Water.
Shelter.
Sanitation.
Food.
Well, just be careful with sanitation. I said anyone who has ever lived.
Oh, okay.
I mean, we'll get to that in a minute, I suspect.
Hey, Robbie, fire.
Clothing.
Clothing.
Asbestos to keep your house warm.
And Richard said fire. We'll just call it energy. Okay.
What about wine?
Well, it started early on. Okay. So does that list sound legit?
Yep.
All right. Let's assume now a greater living standard, right? What other necessities could we put in there that, say, cavemen didn't have? Because cavemen had these, needed these, right? What other necessities would you put in a real economy? Transport?
Entertainment.
if you want entertainment, have kids. Transport? Healthcare?
Education?
Healthcare?
Machine tools.
Tools? Infrastructure? We'll put it as a more general category than transport.
Education.
I don't need it.
What sort of
education?
Which education?
Robbie, casinos
and prostitution. the town's got that.
Better race track.
Banking system.
Yes.
Gold. Come on.
Communication.
Some form of it. Necessities, yes. So what necessities can we assume with a better standard of living? So communication, you could, whatever form it takes, you'd put communication in, sure.
Healthcare.
We've got healthcare.
Better
housing is I thought better housing is a good one.
Oh,
we'll do better shelter. And better clothes? Would you say better clothes?
And better food. Pure water.
Law and order.
Now, Doug, you put sanitation in here.
Yeah, that's a livable environment.
A good tax
system. A what?
A good tax system.
We're not at a financial system yet. We're at necessities.
Where are the carbon credits?
Carbon credits. And if we're going to have education there, maybe we should put something and someone through in entertainment. Was that you? What don't we put in culture?
What about law and order?
Okay. So does that look like a good list? Does that look like a good list? Right. No. Okay. So how much? So I think that's a good list. Not all my questions are trick questions.
There's one missing.
What?
Government.
Well, we can.
If you're getting to all this stage, you need something to manage it all. More and order.
All right. That's now we're getting more philosophical. I want to have things in the list that no one would doubt. Okay. So how much, let's call this the real economy, put a label on it. Is that a good name?
Yeah.
Yep. How much is that of the present economy?
How much of the present financial system serves that? What do you think? So it's pretty low. Would we guess it's pretty low?
Not necessarily. It's dominating it more and more.
Serves it. Not eats
zero.
It. Not feeds off it.
Yeah.
Facilitates it.
Zero.
Okay. Well, let's. Well, I've got some.
Sorry, did you say the whole world? Are you including China?
Yeah. No. Well, those are the contradictions. So yeah. No, but no, I don't want to. I want to think in terms of just types. So, Sam and I discussed this last night. When's the crash going to happen? Well, because the world is the world and it's interconnected. You've got what we're about to go through in a bit of detail. But then you've got balances to that, which is like China, right? Has kept the world economy going since 2008. But our financial system, let's just take ours, the part of the which we are an extension of the transatlantic financial system. Let's see how much actually serves and facilitates this real economy. All right, so.
What about control? We need control.
Well, someone.
Yeah.
What we're talking about, Tony, is a. We'll get to that in a minute because you do need that, but that's about how you bring that about, right, Frank?
The trading medium.
Yeah. Well, so we put communications, infrastructure, and transport. That would, if you've got those, you're going to be able to trade. Some of those things happen normally. But what we're talking about is the, what are the things that we need? But anyway, so we don't have to make it comprehensive. Are we happy with what's on the list?
Yeah.
Is there something that shouldn't be on the list? That's the real question. So it's all fits? All right? Okay. So let's see how much of the financial system serves this. I've got some stats for you. Basic ones. Cost of housing. Shelter. Used to be 3.5 times the average household income. Household. When households were single income households. It's now in Melbourne 10 times and in Sydney 12 times dual income households.
Yeah.
Right? There's a disconnect for you right there. How the money tied up in the housing market is not about delivering housing.
Nope.
Right? Obvious. For those who don't know, the suburb of Strathfield is 29 times the household income of the people who live in Strathfield.
That's in Sydney.
That's in Sydney, yep.
What is the average?
12. 12. Sydney is 12. We ran in the alert service a month ago, maybe, a graphic, if you see the PDF version, you would have seen the colour one, of the growth of million of suburbs where the median price is $1 million in Sydney. And it's like, 2009, there was a few spots. 2016, it's like an infectious disease spread across Sydney. The people of Sydney think it's great. They're all paper millionaires. But you look at it, what you're looking at is, if it was a doctor looking at a body, you'd say there's a cancer spreading there, right? Foreign exchange market. Here's a statistic for you. The global turnover in the foreign exchange market, swapping currencies, is between, it's a bit similar to derivatives actually, it's between $1,200 trillion and $1,500 trillion. I actually reckon it's come down slightly from 2014 when it was $6 trillion a day, now it's $4.8 trillion a day. In Australia, we know, we have the fifth highest traded currency in the world, less than 1.5% of the trades of our currency relate to importing and exporting. Less than 1.5%, because that's what currency trading is for. So if you want to export to another country, you can swap our currency with their currency. That's what it's for, right? And until the end of the Bretton Woods system, it was 97% across the board around the world of currency trading was about importing and exporting. Now in Australia, less than 1.5%. So you've got this huge market of currency trading that's got nothing to do with what it was designed to do, right? Gross, did I have a, just hang on a second. It might come up a bit later. Oh, okay, now go back a bit, Aaron, to the derivatives bomb one. So gross domestic product is globally, it's around $50 trillion. Jeremy and I debate that sometimes. $15 trillion US money supply, $100 trillion total value of stocks and bonds. And of course, the derivatives, they don't put a figure on it, but it's the 1,200 trillion or 1.2 quadrillion we talk about. So if GDP, which is already a dodgy figure, right, is the only thing that is meant to represent the real economy, then This is so out of whack. This market is so out of whack, it's not funny. All right, now get this. Just after World War II, this is the share market now, which is the part of the financial system that that is most accessible to you guys if you want to dabble in it. At the end of the World War II, the average share was held in ownership. The average time a share was held in ownership was 4 years. Right, just at the end of in the late 1940s. The average time a share was held in ownership was 4 years. By the year 2000, it was 8 months. Now, this is an average. So you still got, you know, the blue rinse set holding on to their Wesfarmers shares that they were bequeathed or whatever, right? And they're going to hold on to them until they die. But that drop in the average means that something else was going on, this rapid fire speculation. So 2000, it was 8 months. By 2008, the average was 2 months, right? By 2011, it was 22 seconds. The average time shares are held in ownership is now 22 seconds. That was 2011 figures, 22 seconds. That's thanks to a thing called high frequency trading, right? Which is a bigger and bigger and bigger. By 2011, that was 70% of all the stock market, high frequency trading. All right. Yeah? Yeah? 22 seconds.
Not even human beings on the floor yelling and screaming.
No, 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 of course. This is all, it's only possible thanks to computers, right? Okay. So I want to give you some examples that should make your hair curl of the financial system. So what I've done over the last few years, I've read a lot of books, such as this one. I'm going to give Liar's Poker. Now, Michael Lewis is a good author. He wrote The Big Short. I'm assuming most of you saw the movie, right? And what he does, he used to work in Wall Street, and he's very critical of the media for not covering the really interesting stories that anyone worth it will think, if you hear about it, you go, whoa, why don't we know about that? Right, he writes books about it and gives you the details. So I don't want to drown you in details. I want to give you the headline items. But if you want to know, read the books yourselves. They're hair curling. So we'll start off. This is all examples of the financial system disconnect, right? So in this was his first book, Liar's Poker. He was a Salomon Brothers bond trader in the early 1980s, Michael Lewis. And that's why he wrote this book. It's his own story. And Salomon Brothers is where mortgage-backed securities were invented, right? And that's referenced in The Big Short. They pay tribute to this guy Ranieri, who was everyone on Wall Street worships him. He invented this the mortgage-backed security, which of course later on blew up the financial system. Salomon Brothers is also one of the institutions that is the reason for the repeal of Glass-Steagall, because later on it merged into with a broker, Salomon Smith Barney, the broker, and that was bought up by Travelers Insurance. And Citibank wanted to buy Travelers Insurance, which had these investment banking side, the Salomon Brothers, and so they changed the rules so Citibank could do it. So Salomon Brothers has always been a very big, important financial institution on Wall Street. So anyway, as part of his education, as his first year as a trainee, this young trader who's only been there 2 or 3 years, who's a hotshot trader, shows off to him one day. And the way he shows off is, they're bond traders, and their job is basically to sell parcels of bonds, and these are $10 million, $50 million, $100 million parcels of bonds. Their customers are fund managers, right? And usually fund managers for like insurance funds. And the insurance industry is, they are they're the favorite mark of, if you know the term mark for con men, right? Con men always pick their mark. They're the favorite mark for Wall Street predators, especially derivative salesmen as well. Because the insurance industry, it's a sleepy, regulated industry, or it's supposed to be. Because you've put your money with an insurance company so you can insure something. You want to make sure that money is not wasted, right? It's there when you need a payout. So they're regulated and they've got to put it in certain places and there's limits on what they can do. So this young hotshot calls up an insurance fund manager and sells him $50 million worth of bonds. And he tells him, promises him the earth. This is great, this is exactly what you want, etc. Bang, sale made. And then to show off to Michael Lewis, He turns around half an hour later and he calls the same guy back and convinces him to sell the bonds he's just sold to him to another insurance fund manager, right? And there would be beneficial for him to sell those bonds. And why? What was the purpose of this transaction? No. So Salomon Brothers could make a commission. Right? This was how, this was Wall Street in the 80s, before massive deregulation. Just passing things back and forth for no reason. The purpose for holding the bonds for the insurance company is a real purpose. They're putting it somewhere safe and they'll get interest on that, etc. But for the investment banks, they just want to throw things around, right? And they are parasites. They're sucking off the top through commissions, etc. And this was his entree into Wall Street. Now, I want to make a point. Did anyone see Mnuchin being carpeted by Senator Cantwell, Maria Cantwell? So he had this mealy-mouthed thing, excuse about Dodd-Frank, about Glass-Steagall and about the Volcker Rule, because he said, oh, we're worried what that might do to liquidity. Remember, you know that term, liquidity? All liquidity means is that when someone wants to make a sale in the financial markets, they just want to make sure there's always someone there to buy it. That's what liquidity means. So when these Wall Street guys carry on about how important liquidity is, they're talking about so they can do these unnecessary bullshit sales. If they weren't doing that, it's not as important as they think it is. Right? If Wall Street reflected the real economy, it's not the issue they make it out to be. It's an issue, but it's nowhere near the issue they make it out to be. Because they just want to pass money around and they want to always have some sucker that's going to buy it. And that's where, oh, we need liquidity. All right. Next one, Aaron. So bear with me here. I got the book here. This guy, what's really good about this book, by Frank Partnoy, is he wrote this in 1997. And when I read this book a few years ago, I thought, why weren't they all rounded up and arrested then? There's enough stuff in this book, right, where he's got the guy who, you know, John Mack, who was on Hillary Clinton's fundraising committee for a campaign this year, is in this book in 1994, telling his Morgan Stanley traders, there's blood in the water, let's go rip somebody's face off. That's how they talk. They sent their traders out to skirmish, what do you call it? Skeet shooting, and but also paintball things, right? And the chief trader in the floor was not a mathematics whiz or something like that. It was an ex-army guy who was made the chief trader because he was so verbally violent to his staff, right? He gave them a killer instinct so that they did not, because what does rip your face off mean? Rip your face off means selling something to a client that you know is going to make them a loss, but not care about it. And when it does make them a loss and they complain, you actually cheer, yeah, I'll rip his bloody face off. This is all documented. He got out of it before 1997, because he thought if he stayed in, he'd be going to jail, right? He wrote this book in 1997 and nothing was done. And, you know, eventually all escalated till 2008.
Someone actually advised his former employer to buy up every copy of
it. Well, he's become much more interesting since 2008, that's for sure. So here's two derivatives that he explains. Right, because that's actually another thing. It is worth knowing. It's easier to explain derivatives as in metaphors, right? Gambler's side bets, because that's what they are. You know, it's not even that. We'll use some examples later, but it's not even the initial bet. It's the side bet on the bet. That is what derivatives are. And when you're organising around, that's all you want. But if you want to know, if you want to prove to yourself why that's what they are, you can read a book like this, because he wrote it for the public. He explains in painstaking detail, and he simplifies it, how these derivatives actually work. And I want to give you two examples. So the first one is called PEARLS. Principal Exchange Rate Linked Security. And they invented this derivative so that it looked like a bond. So they could sell it to these people I said before, the insurance fund managers, because they were only allowed to buy bonds. So they sold him a thing that looked like a bond. Now, a bond has a set term, right? 5 years, 10 years. And when it matures, so you get an interest payment. And when it matures, you get your principal back. That's a bond, right? It's not unlike like a normal loan, which is amortized and whatever, you know, so you pay it, the principal and capital over time. Bond is principal and capital separate and interest separate, and you get the principal back at the end. So it looked like a bond, and these guys could buy it. Now, insurance fund managers were forbidden in those days from speculating on foreign exchange. But some of them wanted to because they're Wall Street, they were trained as Wall Street predators too, and they never met a rule they haven't wanted to get around, right? So these investment banks invented a bond that looked like a bond. It had an interest set interest payment, and it was a high interest payment. And for an insurance fund manager, it's like, whoa, government bond 4%, I can get 7%? That's great, I'll get a bigger bonus this year. But the principal repayment at the end was not a straight repayment. It was tied to the fluctuations in three currencies, a formula, right? That worked out that they had a formula in there, and it was based on where those three currencies were in relation to each other. There was a chance that you got your principal back and a little bit more. And of course, that chance was talked up. There was a far greater chance that you got far less than your principal back and even none at all. So, such is the nature of currency markets. Right? They can fluctuate wildly. And they sold billions of dollars of these things. And the essence is one thing, fraud. Here's the rule, we're going to invent something to get around the rule. And does it matter to the investment bank salesman that they're selling something so dangerous? No. Does it even matter to the insurance fund manager? Not really, because it's not his money. It matters to, he might keep his job or not keep his job, more kept their jobs than should have, but it's, at the end of the day, it's not his money, right? And that's the type of thing that this industry, this sector of the financial system feeds on, and people have written books called, like John Kay wrote, Other People's Money, to capture the mentality that goes on here. And it's all our money in some respect. Yep.
That was the start of it. So what the bloody hell is now going on with this creativity that they're using?
We're getting there. Yeah. Hold it. Now,
it's stagnant.
So Phil just said that's the start of it. At the beginning of this book, what Frank Partnoy does, he first worked for Bankers Trust, which was the big derivatives pioneer on Wall Street in the 80s. Bankers Trust is now Deutsche Bank. It's one of the reasons Deutsche Bank is this big derivatives mess, because it used to be Bankers Trust.
Just on that, Robbie, correct me if I'm wrong, but I think Westpac picked up their Australian unit, BT.
Maybe after they did the Australian wheat board over. Bankers Trust did that thing with the wheat board, remember, where they got you all to buy shares in it and whatever. Yeah. So that's the type of mentality that comes up with those types of schemes. Okay, another thing. The second one is called the MX missile, which we've explained in CEC reports. And it was called the MX missile because when they, at the top, you know, this was in the early 90s, the Reagan administration had unveiled this massive weapon, the MX missile. So this related to them, Morgan Stanley, being able to help Japanese banks hide their losses. A lot of Japanese banks made big losses on Barings Bank when it collapsed. And of course, for the Japanese, you know, honor is everything, right? And the collapse of Barings came through just before the end of the financial year in Japan. And these banks had been making a profit. Barings collapsed. They'd all speculated on it. We're all facing huge losses. To save face, Morgan Stanley came along and invented a derivative for them that could help them hide that loss. And he explains it as the pot of gold, right? The $100 pot of gold. Just I'll use the gold analogy, but they talk about mortgage-backed securities in this pot of gold because of this quality of mortgage-backed securities where you can slice and dice them, right, and move them around. So imagine you've got a $100 pot of gold. You've paid $100 for this thing. Half of the gold, though, is real, and it's worth $90. Half of it is fool's gold, and it's worth $10, right? If you sold the half that's real for $90, it cost you $90, you sell it for $90, you haven't made a profit. Nothing. Nothing's changed. So what do? You revalue both halves on your book as an average. So you average each half out where the $90 real is valued on your books at $50. The $10 fake is valued on your books at $50. And you take that, the real pot of gold, and you sell it because people like the real gold, they're happy to buy it off you, right? And you sell it for $90 and you're marking up a $40 profit every time. And you can do this indefinitely as long as you don't sell the other half. And these banks have sat on those other halves for years, right? Chalking up profits on paper that are not real. There's only one word for this. This is fraud, right? This is 1994 and 1995. Daisuke Kitagawa had to go through and clean this up in 1998 and 1999. It's why he sent friends in Japan to jail for dabbling in this, but the Wall Street and London bankers who sold in this crap got away with it, right? Got to go back to nothing happened to them. And in fact, one of them, of course, was AIG Financial Products, and all he could do was warn them. They got out of Japan and went and set up in London and literally blew up the world in 2008 with their credit default swaps. Okay, if you saw The Big Short, you've seen this example. This is synthetic collateralized debt obligations.
Well, here's Dr. Richard Thaler, father of behavioral economics, and Selena Gomez to explain.
Okay, so here's how a synthetic CDO works. Let's say I bet $10 million on a blackjack hand.
$10 million because this hand is meant to represent a single mortgage bond. Okay, Selena has a pretty good hand here, showing 18, dealer showing 7. That's a really good hand for Selena. Good odds. In fact, her chances of winning this hand are 87%.
So, my odds are good. I'm on a winning streak. Everybody in this place wants to get in on the action. How could I lose, right?
Now, this is a classic error. In basketball, it's called the hot hand fallacy. A player makes a bunch of shots in a row. People are sure they're going to make the next one. People think whatever's happening now is going to continue to happen into the future. During the real estate boom, markets were going up and up, and people thought they would never go down.
So people who are watching and think that I won't lose will make a side bet. Now, this is the first synthetic CDO.
I love Selena Gomez. I bet you $50 million she wins. And I'll give you a 3-1 odds.
3-1 odds? Okay, I'll take that bet.
Now, somebody else is going to want to make a bet on the outcome of their bet.
$50 million she wins.
That will lead to synthetic CDO number two.
Hey, I bet you $200 million that lady in the glasses wins that bet.
She probably will win. So I want a great payoff.
About 20-1.
Deal.
And this will go on and on with more and more synthetic CDOs.
And we can transform an original $10 million investment into billions of dollars.
You okay?
No. I actually feel pretty sick.
That last couple, the second couple of bettors, that was the Newcastle City Council. And 11 other Australian town and city councils buying these products. Right, that's all the substance to them was pure betting on bets on other bets. All right, did you show them my little cartoon?
No, I didn't get
it. Yeah, go back to the. All right, this is where the CDOs were, yeah. Oh, well, Grange, Lehman Brothers, Australian subsidiary called Grange Securities, sold those CDOs, collateralised debt obligations, to a whole bunch of Australian councils including Newcastle City Council.
What did the council think that they were buying?
They thought they were buying a high interest security, AAA rated security. AAA rated, high interest, that's all that mattered to them. Well, Anne and I met the guy from the coast, just near the airport there in Sydney.
Rockdale.
Yeah. The former mayor of the Rockdale Council asked he's the elected mayor. He asked his financial controllers or the bureaucrats what they were investing in. They wouldn't tell him. As the mayor, he had no right to know what they were investing in, and they invested in it too. Yeah, they're obliged. There are rules, right? That you got to put your money in the best place possible. So once you slap AAA on it, ta-da, right? It set them all up. Sorry? Yeah, rate. People, they're putting money they should be spending on potholes into this stuff.
Because the reason we found where we rang those councils is the CEOs actually have total control, don't they, of some councils.
Well, for some, say, and Richard referenced the councils come under the control of state governments, and I would really suspect that's where the corruption lay. For some reason, Lehman Brothers was allowed to go and prey on those councils, right? Someone gave them the all clear, whether they set up at one of these, you know, junkets that where councils would go to and whatever, and they were given access to prey on them, and they did. Yeah. That's right. Australia, the judge's ruling in Australia was actually the best ruling in the world. Right. It's the only that what he did was right. There's some bloke based in Japan or whatever who had picked up the carcass of Lehman Brothers. Had much more than he shouldn't have had anything, this guy. He was one of them, so they should have all been wiped out. Whatever was left, he was trying to squirrel away for himself and do other speculating with it, and this Australian court decision has affected that. That'd be right. Anyway, does anyone want to convince me this stuff's got anything to do with the real economy yet? Okay, but because I like rubbing it in, if you've got an open sore, we're going to put some salt on it.
The only part of the real economy is that the banks are holding the real wealth at the moment. But although they hold the real wealth, if their wealth goes up, that means the real economy has to go down.
Well, and we'll get to that point in a minute. Okay, next one please, Aaron. So this is one of the more recent books I've read. We're now going to describe a bit of what's happened leading up to 2008 and past 2008, because what's happened since 2008 is worse than before 2008. It's not really promoting them, but it's not condemning them either. So it just gives you a clear insight into the mentality of even the innocent, you know, do their job every day guys on Wall Street, what they accept as assumptions of the financial system should be regarded as insane. It shows you how far we've drifted from reality. Because they worship this guy named Ed Thorpe. And Ed Thorpe was a bloke who in the 60s worked out, he was a mathematician, and he worked out a method for counting cards in Las Vegas casinos. Now, counting cards is not illegal, but the mob, the mafia, who owned Las Vegas casinos, they didn't like it. And if you got caught doing it, well, you might have had a few fingers broken and other things, right? But all you're doing when you're counting cards, if you're smart enough, is you are predicting the odds, whether the odds are going to be in your favor or not. And the particular method, I can't explain it, except that if he could tell that more large denomination cards were in the pack, still in the pack, the odds were in his favor, and he could make bigger bets then and more likely come out on top. Right, so he figured this out. He wrote, this is a pretty transparent guy. He wrote a book about it called Beat the Dealer, right? A lot of people around America were, woohoo, we've now got, you had Wall Street guys pulling their money out of Wall Street to invest in gambling consortiums that he headed because that was a better bet than Wall Street, right? Except Las Vegas wasn't run by the Securities and Exchange Commission. It was run by, you know, Lucky Luciano, right? So Ed Thorpe decided at a certain point it's in his interest to not go to casinos anymore. And he thought, well, I'm not going to go to a casino, but I know where I can keep gambling. And he went to Wall Street. And he took the same approach to Wall Street, and literally the same approach, where you're looking at movements, you're looking at investment decisions, collective investment decisions. You're looking at stock market fluctuations, just like the cards coming out of the blackjack deck, right? And you're doing probability calculations, which are very sophisticated, but you're thinking, okay, can I predict the odds of the movement being in this direction or that direction? And they could predict them. They were very, very good at this. They could predict where the market would go. So then they could make investments accordingly. They're not investing in a stock. They're not investing in General Electric so it can put money to work and build a power plant and they make some money from the profit. They're making an investment so they can predict that based on their certainty the market will go in a certain direction, so they can then turn around and sell it a little while later, right? And they make a profit out of that. So this, if there is a role for the stock market in the economy, and I say there is a certain function there. Get people to invest in companies, pull your money, company does a good job, everyone shares a profit, you get a dividend. This was taking it completely away from that, right? And it worked. And of course, the more it worked, the more it attracted investors. It's like, here's an analogy. Just imagine a market, like a farmer's market, a Sunday farmer's market here in Coburg or whatever, or anywhere. So there's stalls selling everything you want, food, clothes, kids' toys, whatever. And there's one stall sets up where you can go and make bets, and you're betting on where the money is going to be spent that day in the market. And the people making the bets are very good at it, and they get better and better. And people realize you can go there and make bets at that table, and you can make a lot of money making bets at that table. And after a while, all the money that's coming into the market goes to the betting table, and no one's spending any money at the market anymore, right? This is the overall state of the economy. There's a flaw built into their method, though. There's a flaw, and that is this. Is anyone familiar with Brownian motion?
Yeah.
Okay. The actual mathematics of calculating probabilities was based on Brownian motion, which is the short, jerky step. Brownian motion has been compared to a drunk man walking, right? Where there's a direction, but there's a lack of direction as well, right? And it's a bit unpredictable. So for those who are interested, that could look it up. But everything is based on short little movements. And for the mathematics to work, it ignores big unpredictable events. So you could calculate a drunk man walking across a bridge, right, and work out the odds of which side he'll end up bumping up against the rail on. But you would not include in that calculation the probability that the bridge might collapse. That wouldn't come into it, right? Except, as unlikely as that is, in the real world, sometimes bridges collapse. And that's the flaw that was built into this system that is still the flaw at the heart of this kind of trading in Wall Street today. They ignore the big, they're trained to ignore the big probabilities. If you're asked to, if you learn statistics, you're taught, if you're given four numbers, 13, 5, 22, and 781, you're going to ignore 781. It's an outlier. And you're going to concentrate on the three numbers that are closer to each other because they're more related to each other. And if you do that, things can happen. So consequently, there's been the big crashes on Wall Street since the 90s, like long-term capital management, was based on an outlier event, a big event coming along. In case long-term capital management, it was the default of Russian bonds. No one had ever thought that possible. Bang, it hit, all the bets that long-term capital management that it had been raking in the money, all the bets went bad, bang, vaporized, and nearly brought down Wall Street with it. In 2005, these quants, the quantitatives, there's a section in The Big Short where there's a bit of a scene there with the, he points to the Chinese guy in the corner, he says, that's my quant. And they said, what's that? They had all these bets on the stock market, and then General Motors suffered a bond downgrade. And General Motors, the biggest corporation in the world, that's impossible, right? Bond downgrade, all their bets went bad. And then, of course, I'm going to tell you one what that happened in 2007. But first, let me introduce it. So, July 25, 2007. Lyndon LaRouche was giving a speech, and this is what he said. And this, up to this point, for those who've got a good memory, what had happened was some hedge funds associated with Bear Stearns had got into trouble, and they had investors in them, including the Prince Charles Hospital and Nurses Fund in Perth and some Victorian Teachers Fund lost money in these two hedge funds that went under, right? Anyway, that's all that happened so far. And Lynn said this, the world monetary financial system is actually now currently in the process of disintegrating. There's nothing mysterious about this. I've talked about it for some time. It's been in progress. It's not abating. What's listed as stock values and market values in the financial markets internationally is bunk. Do you agree with him?
Yes.
There are purely fictitious beliefs. There is no truth to it. The fakery is enormous. There is no possibility of a non-collapse of the present financial system. None. It is finished now. And this happened on the 3rd of August.
What year was
that? 2007.
Everything sort of starts out down a little bit, but nothing to worry about. Ah, boring summer fight. Almost, a day we haven't had in a long time. Right. Just not exciting. Then all of a sudden S&P says, ooh, we're worried about bear.
Right.
Bear goes down. Market goes down. And then all of a sudden, things kind of calm down. Bear comes out and says, hey, we're okay, guys. We're okay. Everything's fine. Bear goes back up to neutral. Market's only down 20.
Right.
Then bear comes out and says, worst bond market in 22 years. Yeah. And that's where we are right now. The market's down 100 points.
Memo
How do
Bear
you trade
Stern,
this?
Memo to Bear Stearns. You got to adopt a Henry Ford attitude here, which is never explain, never complain. And they didn't do that. You keep your mouth shut during this period. You don't say a thing. Because you're going to say something
but
that people don't like.
But then we complain and we say, hey, come on, guys,
keep your mouth shut.
Come out here and talk about your exposure.
You speak softly and you wait to that level where you think the shorts have overdone the stock, and then you do what Dick Fold did in 1998. You pick up the phone to guys like me and you say, 32 bid, 1 million. And then you get whacked and you come back and say, 31 bid for 2 million. They're not doing that. That inspires more fear. I don't want to create fear. I like Bear Stearns very much, but I think that at this stage, this is not a good call. They shouldn't have done it, and they should have just said, you know what?
Mm-hmm.
We're doing well, and don't say another thing. Just don't say it, because it does not inspire confidence to have 10 headlines coming over about what to do. I don't like it.
All right, I hear you. Now, I still, though... You know, when we said,
and,
hey,
look, the Dow can rally. We've seen the Dow rally.
No, I know. I'm not even, but I mean, it's just interesting, this bigger...
Well, this is about Bernanke. This is about Bernanke. He has to be on that call. Forget the investors. The investors are going to do... If Bernanke
Bernanke
needs to open the discount window. That's how bad things are out there. Bernanke needs to focus on this. Alan Greenspan told everyone to take a teaser rate and then raise the rate 17 times. And Bernanke is being an academic. It is no time to be an academic. It is time to get on the Bear Stearns call. Listen, open the darn Fed window. He has no idea how bad it is out there. He has no idea. He has no idea.
Kramer.
I have talked to the heads of almost every single one of these firms in the last 72 hours, and he has no idea what it's like out there. None! And Bill Poole has no idea what it's like out there. My people have been in this game for 25 years, and they are losing their jobs, and these firms are going to go out of business, and he's nuts! They're nuts! They know nothing!
All right, that'll do.
Since I went 5 bid...
Okay. That was the early afternoon show. Sorry?
He is definitely upset.
That was the early afternoon show, Friday afternoon on CNBC. After that aired, because it's live, the stock market tanked. It ended the day down 281 points. Now, the next week, on the Monday, though, an invisible crash happened that is one of the biggest crashes in Wall Street, but nobody outside these quants and banks knew about it because the market on the Monday went up 287 points. It went up 36 points on Tuesday and 154 points on Wednesday. But what was happening behind the scenes, and I want to just describe this to you, so bear with me. They had what was called the quant crash, where all these guys, everything I've described with these quants, one of the things, just points to make about them, it's only possible with computers. That's why the age of the quant and this kind of trading has taken over. It's they don't do the trades, they pre-program algorithms to do the trades, right? And they're always looking for an angle of what they can do. So all these quants had their computerized algorithms trading away like crazy, everything's going well, and they came in on the Monday and they started losing billions and billions and billions of dollars while the stock market was going up. And here's why. Because of what he's talking about, one or two big players who had lost their shirts on subprime mortgages and what was happening to Bear Stearns, they had to get out of their trades. They had to sell, cut and run. And a lot of their trades were short selling. So if you've already heard the term short selling. So short selling is a bet that the market's going to fall, right? And what you do is you short sell stocks. You've got stocks that you think are good, General Electric, you know, Goldman Sachs, you're not going to short sell them, you're going to sell KFC, whatever, right? And even if there's nothing fundamentally wrong with the company, if it's the kind of company that tends to fluctuate because it's not a big company or it's got that kind of volatility, you'll short sell it anyway because you will make money on the spread. That's why they do it. So all this is pre-programmed. So one or two big players went on a massive selling out of their investments, including these short sells, but let me just explain a short sale first. So you're betting a stock will go down. What you do is you sell that, you borrow that those shares for the stock you want to short, you borrow them from somebody else. Now, Australian superannuation funds have got into lending stocks like this for short selling, lending your shares to speculators for short selling. So you're a speculator. You will borrow shares and sell them. So just say you think National Australia Bank is going to go down. It's $100. You will borrow a bunch of shares, sell them for $100. When they get down to 90, you'll buy them back at 90, right? And return them to the person you bought them from, and you pocket the difference. That's what the short selling gamble is. So all these big players have all these borrowed shares and they've got to get out. And therefore, what they've got to do is sell them quickly or buy the ones they've short sold that they expected to go down. Suddenly, to get out of their trades, they've got to start buying those same stocks because they owe those shares back. And all they can do is buy them. And suddenly, all this stock market buying was going on by people who had to get out of their trades to return the borrowed shares. And it's pushing up stocks that all the gamblers had short sold, right? And so all these guys, and the computers are just doing what they're programmed to do. And they were programmed to short sell those shares. And when it moves against them, then they were all pre-programmed for contingencies. And they also had to, in their programming, start buying the same shares that they had been programmed to sell, right? And they're pushing up the stock market to 300 points in a day, while they're making the biggest losses they'd ever made in their lives, right? They all took a huge bath on it, billions and billions and billions of dollars, but the public didn't know because all you see is the morning report about the stock market and the stock market reporter for the morning, Tom, what's his name from ComSec or whatever, would have come up with some theory about why the stock market went up today. Oh, the stock market rallied on, you know, good news of the crop in Western Europe or whatever. Right? Or some, they make it up. They have no idea why the stock markets go up and down as they do. But when you see market volatility, just bear that in mind. A market going up hundreds of points in a day is just as bad as a market going down hundreds of points in a day. that's, you know, because of thanks to the way these guys rig the system, they're not perfect, they're not omniscient, they can't know everything, and they can lose big, and that's what happened on that day.
Beware sense certainty.
Beware sense certainty, yeah. All right, and just one last type. Nick, move it along, Aaron. Okay, this is what's happened since the crash. This has taken over. High frequency trading and these things called dark pools, which I've no idea why any of this is legal, but it is. So Michael Lewis wrote this book, which was one of the first sort of whistleblowing books on high frequency trading. It came about because a Canadian who worked at the Bank of Canada's office in Wall Street was getting sick of every time in 2010 he pushed execute on his screen to execute a trade purchase, a stock purchase for a client. The screen had a quote, a number there of how much he was going to pay, right? $28, $15. And every time he pushed execute, suddenly the quoted number changed to $28.01. Right? And so, you know, you're not buying one share, you're buying 100,000 shares, and those 1 cent add up. Well, you're buying 1 million shares, and those 1 cent add up. And he's going, why? That's the quote's on the screen. What is going on here? And that guy single-handedly started digging into this. It was a side of Wall Street that had grown up under everybody's noses, but people like him, a trader at the Bank of Canada, found it out that the majority didn't find out except by accident, right? That this had been allowed to, and what it was high frequency trading. These same quants with their machines had figured out that they could program these with processing technology, the modern processing power, you know, that Intel and that keep bringing out. They could program their computers to run their algorithms in fractions of milliseconds, right? They'd put them in deep freezers, they'd put them in basements and get liquid nitrogen in there and reduce the temperature so low that the process, these things are superconductors and they're just going flat out, and they figured that they could have these things programmed, they could process so fast in fractions of milliseconds that then it became a factor of how far they were from the mainframes of the stock exchange. Because if they were up the street, like if the cable connecting to the stock exchange went out the stock exchange door, up the street, down that way, up there, you know, like all those turns and twists was extra distance, which is extra time in milliseconds. It makes 0.1 of a millisecond, 0.2 of a millisecond. And what's the point of that? Get it down to 0.1 of a millisecond. So the stock market gave them permission to set up these servers in the stock market building itself next to the mainframe. There was a few competitors involved, I think it was about four, and they were given permission to have a 1 meter cable each, so that was fair between them. But the rest of the whole trading community has no idea this is happening, right? And there, what that allowed them to do was front run orders, detect orders coming in from all those donkey cart pedestrian traders with their normal systems, right? Detect the order coming in for buying and selling and front run it, so they could make that buy first and push the price up by a fraction, or make the sell first and push the price down by a fraction. And effectively, it's like what they created was a system of electronic scalping. Yep. That's what it is, right? Insider trading. The only thing that gets them away with it not being insider trading is because no human can think that fast. No human is complicit in the decision making. But it is, it's insider trading, it's electronic scalping, and why is this legal? And when the Canadian bloke confronted the Securities and Exchange Commission, which is supposed to police Wall Street, the response he got was that they, as the policeman, had no idea why this should be considered illegal. Anyway, so it's all crazy. This has led to...
It got to a point that it's so crazy that they dug a trench perfectly straight between Chicago and New York, and they bulldozed houses.
It's the longest trench in the world between New Jersey and Chicago, and the whole purpose of this trench is to have fiber optic cable there so the communication time is 13 milliseconds. And the point of it is that Chicago has the futures market, New York has the day market, right? And the difference, there's always a slight difference in price between the futures market and the day market, and that creates an opportunity called arbitrage, buy cheap, sell dear, right? Fractions of cents, fractions of seconds, milliseconds, and they went to all that effort to hundreds of millions of dollars to build this trench to do it. And this is where the financial markets have gone since they blew up in 2008. In other words, they obviously recognise their mistakes and decide to improve, right?
Infrastructure.
That's right. Infrastructure. Well, once this came out, what's his name? Alan Kohler on the ABC wrote about it. Once these books came out, it got attention. Dark pools, by the way, relates to this. It just refers to the fact that all the big banks on Wall Street have created a trading system of their own, platform of their own, where they're such big institutions, when they trade stocks, they can trade them with their own entities and not through the New York Stock Exchange. So they can help manipulate the price to what they'd like it to be. And then when they want to trade outside the dark pool, they announce a price that catches the stock exchange unaware because they didn't know there'd been all this trading going on inside the dark pool. And it's all done through the algorithms and whatever and as well. There's a new movie out called The Money Monster. Lisa and I watched the other night, which sort of relates to this. George Clooney is a Kramer character, and a guy comes in with a gun and has lost a lot of money on a high-frequency trading operation, and he's all upset about it. But they try and claim in this movie that the algorithms can't be wrong, and that's just not true. They can be completely flawed. All right. So, what does this have to do with the real economy?
Nothing.
What effect does it have on the real economy? Is it a beneficial effect or a damaging effect?
Damaging.
All right, so I'm not putting words in your mouth, right? That's obvious?
Yep.
Like, the only reason you wouldn't flush Wall Street down the toilet is because it would physically block the pipes, and those pipes are necessary. There's no other purpose to this. So it's not just damaging. Like, you know, as this has developed in Wall Street and London and that, a larger and larger percentage of physics graduates, engineering graduates, people who should be learning how to make nuclear-powered rockets to get us to Mars, are going to Wall Street to program these algorithms. Because you need to be, they do get, you know, you and I can't do it. They get the very smartest kids to do this, but those kids are all flawed. That's damage there, right? There's numerous examples of damage you can think. If you're a farmer, you know the damage that financial markets do to you every goddamn year. Right, someone is, whether it's the, if the price is up, the currency's bad, right? If the currency's good, the price is bad. And all these prices and figures are being affected by trading that's all manipulated by this kind of system. When South Australia had its blackout the other week, the gas-fired power station didn't turn on because although the spot price of electricity was high, the spot price of gas was higher. And so the decision was not based on the need of South Australia, the decision was based on a market decision, right? And then, you could say that maybe that's unintentionally damaging. This mentality has led to something that has been absolutely intentionally damaging.
And Robbie, you know what is the biggest damage?
What?
Because when you do this activity, this is a crime, of course there are thousands of them, they're eligible to go to jail, they corrupt the government as well.
All right, so this is... Now, these guys did go to jail, but only because they worked in an energy company, not a bank, and because it was 2001.
You're getting rich. Trying to.
Traders would stay after a 12-hour shift and pour over maps of the Western energy grid. What are the permutations and combinations of ways to move power around the West? And I think that's something that Enron knew better than any other energy marketer in the country, period.
We know all of the California imports. We know all of the California load.
They're getting pretty spoiled on some money.
You said you were getting a little scared or making a little too much, and I tend to agree with you.
These are two traders, T-R-A-D-E-R-S. This is what they say. What we did was overbook the transmission line we had the rights on and set to California Utilities. If you want to use the line, pay us. By the time they agreed to meet our price, rolling blackouts had already hit California, and the price for electricity went through the roof. Did you have any knowledge that this was happening?
The only thing that I'm aware of, Senator, is there was a difference of opinion on the rules of the independent system operator. It was just set up. The rules weren't quite clear.
We have traders here from Enron who were saying they did something wrong, but you don't see anything wrong. I have one last question, and then I am done.
Traders soon discovered that by shutting down power plants, they could create artificial shortages that would push prices even higher.
Hey, this is David up at Enron.
Uh-huh.
There's not much demand for power at all, and if we shut it down, could you bring it back up in 3 or 4 hours?
Oh, yeah.
Why don't you just go ahead and shut her down then, if that's okay?
Okay.
When you see 2 or 3 energy companies with 30-35% of their entire capacity down for maintenance on a single day, and as a result, the price of electricity skyrocketing 300-400%, and then a week later someone else does it up in Northern California, you begin to believe something's not smelling right here.
I want you guys to get a little creative.
Okay.
And come up with a reason to go down.
Like a forced outage type thing.
Right.
Those guys, at the flip of a switch, could just yank the California economy on its leash whenever they wanted to, and they did it, and they did it, and they did it, and they made so much money.
The heart of it is that an industry that went for 100 years, from the days of Edison, built the best electrical system in the world, sold the power at reasonable prices to consumers, and was very reliable, was all of a sudden turned into a casino.
So that was Enron. That documentary is called The Smartest Guys in the Room. And of course, Enron came crashing down in 2001, but Enron was an energy company that became a financial trading company. The Glass-Steagall Act, when it was repealed, Glass-Steagall had also forbidden banks from, you know, investing in things like utilities. So JP Morgan went in and took over where Enron left off. And that's what's been in the case in America ever since. Okay. I think I've made my point, right? That's not the real economy. And the reason I've taken the time to emphasize it so much is because when you're organizing, and when you're especially talking to these members of parliament, and they start defending the modern financial system, give them you know, the benefit of the doubt, they have no idea about this, but they should have an idea about this, right? It's criminal, and if they're defending it, and they're trying to tell you how good it is, then they need your advice, put it that way, right? And don't take a backward step, because it is garbage. So the part we're going to talk about Alexander Hamilton is very short, because the whole point with Alexander Hamilton is, how do you make sure that the real economy works, right? That was his challenge when he was the Treasury Secretary. Can you move to Hamilton? He had a big problem on his hands. It was, in their days, it was a problem as challenging as our problem, right? They had the devastation of war. They'd won the war, but of course, a lot of damage of the war. They had huge debts, right? And he, as the Treasury Secretary for the government, said, how do we make this work? We've got to get our economy, our real economy, functioning again. And the answer was, where's the italicized bit? Italicized bit here. Anyway, blah, blah, blah. We need to have something that's going to do the job. He wrote this before 1781, so he became the Treasury Secretary in 1790. So the point of this quote is to show that he had a plan all ready to go. I mean, the institution of a national bank is what the plan was going to be. But then look at this. This is a very important sentence here. Industry is increased, commodities are multiplied, agriculture and manufacturers flourish, and herein consists the true wealth and prosperity of the state. Right? That's Hamilton in a nutshell right there. Now, I'm going to he narrowed it down, the solution, to two words, national bank. I'm going to narrow it down to one word, just so there's no doubt in your mind. See, we live in an economic and political culture that's demonized this word. Government is us. Government is an agency of civilization. Do you want to go back to when we didn't have governments? Right? Government is the agency of the common good. Yes, it can be bad, but then so can, you know, fission. I mean, as in fission power, not fishing. Right? Nuclear bombs are bad. Nuclear power is good, and nuclear power is very good. Right? Government is good. The agency to do this is the government. There's no ifs, buts, or maybes. That's what got Hamilton his enmity, which is where what Tony went through with Thomas Jefferson, because Thomas Jefferson didn't want to have a government. He wanted a bare bones government. What these Montpelier idiots talk about, just the only thing government should do is defense, right? Everything else, no government at all, garbage. The government has a role in the financial system to make it work and in the economy. Next quote, please. So he sets up the First Bank of the United States. Let me just go through this quickly. The details are not that important, but except to illustrate that a government with good intentions can solve any problems. So he had the challenge facing Hamilton was mainly the debt at first. They had an economy that was devastated and they had to get it going, but they had this debt burden. What do you do with all this debt? And the figures for the debt were, it was something like, okay, domestic debt, the US government's debt to the domestic economy was $42.4 million. Its foreign debt was $11.7 million. And the combined debts of the states were $21.5 million. And the first thing he said was, okay, states, give us your debt. We, the new federal government, will pay your debt. And they were all happy with that, right? Some states had more debt because they'd had a bigger burden during the war. The Revolutionary War was mainly fought up north, right? The southern states didn't have quite a burden, etc. But they all happily gave their debts to the federal government. So now the federal government had more debt, had $60 million domestic debt. And the first thing Hamilton did was roll over that debt or refinance it. He said to all the people, here, I'm going to issue a new loan, $60 million loan. You can buy it. Please lend us your money. But what we want you to lend us, pay for it, is in the scrip, the certificates that you hold of the old debt. You've got certificates there saying we owe you so much. Well, we're going to give that to us. We'll owe you that amount again, but we're going to do it over a longer period of time. Instead of 6% interest, it's going to be 4% interest. But the bill, the first bill passed by the US Congress, was a taxation bill tied to repaying the debt. And so when Hamilton said to the public, your repayment is guaranteed, they could believe him. And what he did by doing that was he proved to them that this new government that didn't have much in the way of resources really was a good credit risk, right? He established the full faith and credit of the United States. You can now trust us to pay you back, right? And it set up the authority of the government in the financial system and the economy, that act alone. The new debt certificates that people got were so ironclad that they didn't have a currency before that. You had gold and silver and each bank had their own notes and it was all very chaotic. Those new certificates became the currency. People would happily accept them as currency. You know, you want to buy your neighbor's farm. Here, I don't have any gold and silver, but I've got government debt certificates. Will you take them? Oh, yeah, of course I'll take them. Right? And it became a new currency. Then he set this up, the First Bank of the United States. And the government put up $2 million of the $10 million capital. As a corporation with $10 million capital, it was the biggest corporation in America. He didn't go small, right? It was the biggest corporation operating in America. The government put up $2 million and he said to the public, you can subscribe to the rest and you can pay three quarters of it by using your debt certificates. Pay one quarter in gold and silver, but use your debt certificates. So here he's taking the government's IOU and turning it around as the capital for the bank that then is able to do this. The First Bank acted as the federal government's fiscal agent, collecting tax revenues, securing the government's funds, making loans to the government, very important, transferring government deposits through the bank's branch network, which was the biggest in the country, and paying the government's bills. It managed the Treasury's interest payments to European investors in US government securities. Besides its activities on behalf of the government, the Bank of the United States also accepted deposits from the public and made loans to private citizens and businesses. So
it's the $100 note.
It's the $100 note. And it was, and it's why King O'Malley wanted our bank to not be a central bank, like just a central bank alone, but also be a savings bank to the Australian public, right? He said, "I am the Hamilton of Australia." Next one. Now here's the point. So in 1795, he's able to report back that something very important, and I might have to interpret this comment for you, but just to, so you don't miss the point. He's having a crack here at the whinges in the private banks, because they were complaining. By 1795, after 4 years of this bank operation, they were complaining about this bank getting so much business in the economy. That was their whinge, right? Everyone's doing business at the government bank, at the national bank. And so he says this: if the individual capital of this country has become more adequate to the exigencies than the formerly, it is because individuals have found new resources in the public credit, i.e. the bank, in the funds to which that has given value and activity. Let public credit be prostrated and the deficiency will be greater than before. Public and private credit are closely allied, if not inseparable. There is perhaps no example of the one being in a flourishing where the other was in a dead state. A shock to the public credit would therefore not only take away the additional means which it has furnished, but the derangements, disorders, distrusts, and false principles which it would engender and disseminate would diminish the antecedent resources of private credit. In other words, listen, you whingers, yes, you have a smaller share of the financial system, but your share is bigger than what it would be if the public bank didn't exist. Thanks to this bank, this economy has expanded out of sight, and you don't have all of it. You don't have your monopoly anymore, but you've got a huge amount of business. So shut your whinging, get back in your box, and, you know, very similar to what Curtin and Chifley did in World War II. What are we up to? Okay. So, just to recap. There's a real economy, there's an unreal economy. You have a bit of an insight today into how unreal the unreal economy actually is. It's huge, the unreal economy, right? It's huge. Let's hope he knows that. Jeff was wrong this morning, yesterday, when he said he thought he was here in 2002. He was here in 2000. I remember the conference he attended, LaRouche had just given a speech called "Have You Ever Seen an Earthen Dam Crumble?" And LaRouche described the financial system then, in 2002, as like a great big skyscraper. We played this in Perth for the CLA launch. Great big skyscraper where all this stuff is happening. And down in the very bottom basement level of the skyscraper, there's a little guy with a hammer and an anvil tapping away. And that's the sum total of the global physical economy, right? Keeping everything above it going. And that really is the situation. So if you're going to reverse that, the only agency that can do it is government. The first thing to do is cut off the parasite. And what's that policy called? Glass-Steagall. The second thing to do is get the credit going back into what's going to make things work again, and that's what national banking is. That's the Hamilton principle, right? It's not rocket science. Don't complicate it. But if people want to defend the financial system, rub their nose in it. All right, we'll end it there.